I'm Nick Pettit.
I'm Jason Seifer.
And you're watching The Treehouse Show, your weekly dose of internets where we talk about all things web design, web development, and more.
In this episode, we'll be going over a few different tips and tricks to use in your day-to-day coding. We'll also be giving you an overview of what's new in Mountain Lion as well as Rails 4.0.
Let's get into it. First up is Sprite Cow, available at spritecow.com. Sprite Cow is a pretty nifty tool that you can use to help split up your images on your website. Oftentimes, you'll want to create a sprite to go ahead and increase front-end performance. You'll put all of your tiny images into one big image, then go ahead and upload it to Sprite Cow, and then you can click on each one of those individual images to get the CSS coordinates to set the background image for them. Now, this is pretty nifty because it takes a lot of time to actually do this manually and create all of those CSS coordinates. You have to go into Photoshop, calculate all of the pixels. It's actually a real pain. So instead of doing that, you can just upload your image to SpriteCow. It'll map it all out for you, and then you can just go ahead and use that in your CSS file.
Incredibly, incredibly useful. Especially CSS sprites in general, the process of, you know, taking, like you said, a bunch of tiny images, putting in one big image, overall reduce the number of HTTP requests to your server when serving a web page.
And that'll really increase front-end performance by quite a bit. Those HTTP requests are actually pretty expensive. So if you're just requesting one image, which is your sprite map, instead of requesting a whole bunch of tiny images, it'll increase front-end performance.
Next up, we're going to be talking about Mountain Lion, the new operating system release from Apple. Mountain Lion just came out, and a couple things developers are going to need to take into account. One thing is Gatekeeper. If you submit your applications to the Mac App Store, well, you're probably already aware of Gatekeeper. But if you don't, you'll need to be aware that your users have to actually check a box inside System Preferences to allow untrusted applications to run. Other interesting things inside of Mountain Lion are the Notification Center, because let's face it, we don't have enough distractions day to day already. We now need notifications on our phones and our desktops all at the same time. Thanks, Mountain Lion, for adding that. Also new, Xcode 4.4, which is going to bring you up to speed with iOS version 6.0 SDK, as well as a ton of other features and gigabytes in the download. Game Center is finally on the Mac. But everyone knows Macs can't play games.
Yeah, I thought Macs couldn't play games. They just have that little hockey puck mouse with just the one button.
Yeah, exactly.
How are you going to play games?
Also new is Safari 6.0. Safari 6.0 is actually an exciting release for web developers. Some things that it supports are the Web Audio API, CSS filters, HTML5 web notifications, so you can actually have web pages notify you too, instead of just your phone. There's also HTML5 timed text tracks. This is very useful for adding things like subtitles to, you know, videos on websites. I don't know where we would find any of those.
Possibly on teamtreehouse.com.
Shameless self-promotion. Also, Safari 6.0 supports the latest JavaScript standard. It also has probably my favorite feature. I can't figure out a legitimate use for it, but as far as pranks go, there's private browsing detection built into the JavaScript engine.
So when people visit your website, you could actually detect if they're in private browsing mode.
Right.
And you could say, like, hey, look behind
you. Yeah,
look
out behind you.
What you looking at, buddy? So
I can't actually think of a legitimate use for this other than pranking people.
That's a legitimate use.
And finally, there is a redesigned web inspector in Safari 6.0. If you would like to read a little bit more about what's new in Mountain Lion, Ars Technica has a 28-page summary of what's going on, written by John Siracusa. Go ahead and devour all 28 pages, should you choose to. A little bit more depth than we went into on here.
Just a little bit, like 28 pages worth of more depth.
Yeah, 27 and a half more pages worth.
Next up is Tiny PNG, available at tinypng.org. This is a really nifty tool that can decrease the file size of your ping images. Basically, browsers support pings a little bit differently than what's available in, say, an image editing app like Photoshop. You can actually have indexed PNG images that support alpha transparency within most modern browsers. However, a program like Photoshop won't actually export it this way. So what you can do is export the image normally, as you would in Photoshop, and then you upload it to tinypng.org, and it will actually output the indexed PNG with alpha transparency, and then you can go ahead and use that on your web pages.
Now, why would I want to do something like that, Nick?
Well, it's going to decrease file size pretty dramatically. We have this picture of a cute little panda here eating some grass or bamboo or whatever. What do pandas eat, actually?
Is it panda? I don't know. I'm going to Google that later.
All right. Well, he's eating this green stuff here. And this image is actually 57K, and it's cut down to 17K when it's an indexed PNG with alpha transparency.
So that's quite a savings.
Yeah, that is pretty nifty.
And that's pretty easy, too. Just go and upload the file. Boom. Done.
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 It's instant.
Next up, Ruby on Rails 4.0 is going to be coming out at some point in the future. Thought we'd give you a little bit of an update on what's been going on in Rails 4.0. So kind of the overarching idea of Rails 4.0 is that it's going to be more of an evolutionary than revolutionary release. It's not going to be something where they intend to rewrite everything. If you've had any apps that you've upgraded from Rails 2 to Rails 3, going from Rails 3 to Rails 4 is going to be a much less painful experience. Some things that you're going to encounter, and this is all subject to change, by the way, there is a bare-bones active model implementation. So if you want to get a model that's not backed by the database, it'll be much quicker and simpler to do. There's a smaller and optional action controller implementation for creating things like APIs. There's expanded support for PostgreSQL. I never know how to pronounce that one. PostgreSQL?
Let's move on.
Okay, let's move on. There's expanded support for that particular database's native types. There is a queue being built into Rails. So oftentimes, when you are coding a web application, you might want something to happen outside of the request response cycle. Maybe you go through and update a bunch of people's statuses to something else. And this is something that's going to take way too long to do if you're just going to a web page and waiting for that request to complete. So what you can do is use something called a queue, which is a separate process that operates on your app's environment. Rails 4.0 is going to have one built into Rails that you can optionally use. And what else is interesting about that is that it will be integrated with Action Mailer. So optionally, should you choose to use the queue, all of your emails can head straight into the queue rather than on the normal request response cycle. So if someone signs up to your website, you want to send them a welcome email, drop it in the queue, it'll go out in another second or two.
That's pretty awesome. I bet people are going to be queuing up to download Rails 4 when it's released.
Well done.
All right. Next up is SpinJS, available at fgnas.github.com/spin.js.
That's easy enough to remember.
Yeah, I've got it. Got it memorized. SpinJS is basically a piece of JavaScript that you can go ahead and drop into your website, and it will create this little Ajax-y looking spinner without any kind of images or external CSS required. Now, this is pretty nifty because you can actually go ahead and go on the site and make all sorts of adjustments to what the spinner actually looks like. You can drag these sliders here and increase the length or the width of the lines here. You can increase the radius, the speed. You can add a shadow, all sorts of cool stuff. This is pretty useful if you've ever created any kind of Ajax application that needs some sort of loading animation in between. And, you know, it's very customizable, so not anything crazy, but
I like it.
Still pretty nifty.
I like it. It doesn't require jQuery.
That's right. You can actually use it as a jQuery plugin should you choose to, but it doesn't require jQuery like so many things seem to these days.
Yeah. jQuery's everywhere.
It's everywhere. Can't escape it.
Next up, more on the Rails front, there is talk about the new release of Phusion Passenger 4.0. Phusion Passenger is one of those most widely used deployment servers for Rails. And version 4.0 is going to be coming out soon. The Phusion guys talked about preview release 1 coming out very shortly. Interesting things in Phusion Passenger 4.0 are going to be rolling restarts. What this means is when you roll out a new version of the code for your application, normally what would happen is your application kind of stops while everything gets reloaded, the new code gets reloaded and served. In Phusion Passenger 4.0, what's going to happen is all of the requests are going to finish, and then as new ones come in, the code will be loaded into those requests. What this means is that overall, there's going to be almost no lag time when you roll out a new version of your code. Other things are mass deployment. If you are hosting more than one Rails application, you can just point Phusion Passenger at a directory, and it will load up all of the different Rails applications in subdirectories pointed at their own particular domain name. That is the name of the application directory where they are installed. Finally, a couple things for debugging. There is a live IRB console that you can attach to existing live requests to inspect what's going on. And there is also deployment error resistance. If there is some sort of error when deploying a new version of your code, it will freeze all of the instances and give you a lot more opportunities to debug what's going on.
This really sounds pretty irresistible.
I personally cannot resist it.
Anyway, rolling right along. We're going to talk about UICloud, available at ui-cloud.com. Basically, this is a search engine or a browser where you can go ahead and browse all sorts of UI design patterns. So you just head over to ui-cloud.com and you can go ahead and type in something like progress bar or download button, and you can browse this gallery of all of these rated progress bars. So if you want to make sure that you have the absolute best progress bar possible, you can find the one that has 5 stars and make sure that you go ahead and rip it off. I mean, get inspired by it and go ahead and use it on your website.
If we were to rearrange the web design alphabet, I'd put you and I together.
Wow.
Next up, we have IconMonster. IconMonster is a bunch of free and simple icons for your website. You can go over to iconmonster.com with no E and just kind of scroll through all these icons. They're all free to use in your application. You can also sort them by popularity or randomness. The most popular icon as of this time of recording is somebody slipping on a puddle.
Thanks for that important update, Jason.
I'm not really sure where you would need that in your web application, but if you do, there you go, iconmonster.com.
That's really cool. You know, I really like using icons in web designs, especially if you're like a developer and you're maybe not terribly confident in your design skills. A similar thing is using like CSS grids. It allows you to create a design without stepping too far outside your comfort zone. You know, same thing with icons. You can go ahead and use imagery that's familiar to everybody, and you don't actually have to design it yourself.
Get things done quicker.
That's right. One important thing to be aware of with IconMonster is there's different licensing on different icons. So you want to go ahead and click into each one and make sure that you read the license agreement before just going ahead and ripping it off.
Sounds pretty smart.
Exactly. That's it for this week's episode of the Treehouse Show. Thank you so much for watching. If you have any tips, tricks, or tools that you would like to submit to us, just tweet us on Twitter. I don't know where else they would actually tweet us. But I'm at NickRP on Twitter.
I am at Jay Seifer. Thanks everybody for joining us, and we'll see you next time.
See you later.